Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's an absolute delight to have this opportunity to address you today. My brief today is a very simple one or a very complicated one, depending on your perspective. But essentially, it is to provide you with a quick economic update and with some indication, hopefully, of what to expect over the next 2 to 3 years. Before we dig into all the details around what is happening in the region's economy, in Africa's economy, in the world economy, we have to acknowledge that 2020 so far has been a year of disruption. I think the best way to describe it is that we actually live in an age of disruption. We've had disruption and shocks on a repeated basis since the global financial crisis. And in 2020, we got hit by something hugely unpredictable and unforeseen. Some people have called it a black swan event. But the reality is that we now sit in a situation where the shock we have to deal with is an invisible shock, and it's come in the form of a highly contagious virus, COVID-19. So before we go any further, before we dig into the economics and economic trends and developments, I think it is probably best that we all get onto the same page as far as COVID-19 is concerned. So I'm going to quickly just run you through that picture, where we are at the moment, and how is the disease or the virus progressing across the globe and then in Africa specifically. As far as COVID-19 is concerned, I think the only conclusion we can come to is that the world has not seen the light yet. We are not out of the woods yet. Really, the end of this virus is still not in sight. If you look at these two slides I show you here, essentially we've got the total number of confirmed cases. So these are the cumulative numbers. And then we have the sort of daily new cases that are reported across the globe. And this is what they would generally refer to as the rate of transmission. Now, you can see that as far as the cumulative numbers are concerned, it's truly staggering. We have now reached the point where there are over 14 million cases confirmed globally. And on a daily basis, the rate of transmission, it doesn't appear as if the world at large has reached the peak of this virus yet. If you look at this slide, you can clearly see that initially there was an upward surge coming from China, and as it spread to China, to Europe, which was the second epicenter. And then around April, it looked like the rate of transmission or new cases on a daily basis was starting to sort of form a peak, and it was starting to gyrate at a fairly stable rate around that peak. And then, of course, we saw the virus again start to spread to more states in the United States, to South America. And it's also, we have seen some evidence of a second wave in certain Asian countries and Australia. And of course, it is also starting to pick up in Africa. And as a result, we've seen this second surge up that sort of steep upward slope. And we know we're near peak. So we are still very much in the midst of this crisis. We are still very much dealing with the problems created by COVID-19. Now, obviously, the economic impact across the globe has been disastrous because in many countries, the containment measures that were implemented were not just around healthcare, getting healthcare facilities in order, getting hospitals in order, getting the right number of staff ready to help, getting people in place to do tracking and tracing and getting testing capacity up and running. It has also, of course, entailed quarantine and in many, many cases, complete economic shutdown or lockdown, as it has now the term that really has been coined through this crisis. And of course, if you switch an economy off and you try and turn it on again, the impact can be very, very severe indeed. And that is what we've seen. As for Africa, listen, the virus is spreading across Africa, but the World Health Organization has reported that in Africa, the rate of transmission has actually been a little bit slower than everywhere else in the world. Africa appears to be following very much the Asian curve at this point. In fact, the World Health Organization did a whole study as to why that might be the case. And they've come to the conclusion that, fair enough, and Africa, of course, has very frail healthcare systems, very frail data systems. And as a result of that, there's probably a substantial degree of underreporting of COVID-19. However, they make a valid point that in Africa, communities tend to be far more closer knit communities. They all know each other in a neighborhood. And if people were to suddenly become ill and potentially die for some mysterious reason, it would be very difficult to keep that a secret. And it would at some point or the other have come to the attention of WHO representatives in the various African countries. So they agree and they acknowledge that they do believe the numbers are probably an underestimation of the prevalence of COVID-19 in Africa, but they also feel that it is probably a fair reflection of the rate of transmission. In other words, there hasn't been new hotspots emerging all over the place or rapid acceleration in the rate of transmission in Africa yet. And the reasons they put forward for Africa's apparent sort of resistance to COVID-19 is firstly that Africa is, of course, underdeveloped. We don't have the sort of transport and logistical networks you have elsewhere in the world. And therefore, as a result of that, African mobility isn't as high as it is in Europe and Asia and in many parts of North America and South America. And therefore, if people don't move around that much, the opportunity for them to actually transmit the disease is that much less. So that's been one factor that they've certainly put out there as an explanation for why the virus has spread at a much slower pace in Africa than elsewhere. The other reason they've put forward is that Africa has the youngest population of all the continents. And young people are generally more resilient to this virus and more resistant to this virus. And if they do get it, they are often asymptomatic in that they do not experience it in the same way that people age 40 and over do. And they are not vulnerable in the same way that people age 40 and over are. So that's one other big reason they put it down. And then they generally do feel that African countries have been quite proactive. And they've acted quickly in terms of travel restrictions, in terms of trade restrictions, and that's bought them some valuable time to get their own healthcare facilities in order to deal with the virus. And the bulk of that number, in fact, that you see there, that little green line that is creeping up without a doubt, representing the rate of transmission in Africa, is actually South Africa. So South Africa has seen the largest number of cases. They clearly do the most amount of tests, and you probably have more sophisticated data systems, and therefore the information is known quickly and transmitted the world over. But nonetheless, the bulk of it represents South Africa. And in South Africa, we have seen a very sharp acceleration in the rate of transmission, and we are now currently reporting on a five-day moving average around 13,000 new cases a day. So we are right there where Europe was, where the United States still is. We're in that spot, but it does appear as over the last 5 days or so, even in South Africa, we have seen the number of new cases reported sort of stabilizing at that 13,000 level, which is of course very high. But even though, in the case of South Africa, we've seen this explosion in new cases, the reality is that so far, South Africa has actually not coped too badly. And I think that it is perhaps reflective of what might happen in many other African countries too. Even though we have seen an acceleration in new cases, if you compare South Africa's mortality rate with that of other countries where the virus has spread very rapidly as well, we've done actually exceptionally well. In South Africa, the mortality rate, that is the number of deaths as a percentage of your total confirmed cases, is only 1.5%. It sort of varies between 1.5 and 1.8%. The global average is around 4.5%. So South Africa is well below that, and it's right there with the Asian countries that have actually dealt with this virus very well, and with Australia and New Zealand as well. So not really looking that bad from an African perspective yet, but the reality is for the globe as a whole, COVID-19 remains a threat. And it continues to add to uncertainty, and it continues to disrupt both production and consumption across the globe. And of course, that impacts on demand. And for all of Africa, including East Africa, global demand, global growth is absolutely key to sustaining the momentum in their own economies. And so indirectly, the events that have transpired around COVID-19, the impact that has had on the world economy, will have a very severe impact on Africa. We're going to have a quick look at that now and see how that has played out. Now, the one thing that COVID-19, of course, have brought is a great amount of uncertainty. There is an enormous amount of uncertainty about what will be the impact on the world economy for starters. And with that, of course, which companies will survive this hit, which companies are likely to come through economic lockdown in Europe and Asia and the United States in a relatively good shape, and which ones are likely to fold. And that uncertainty, of course, have weighed on global investors, and it's played out in all the financial markets. The most volatile, of course, have been the equity markets. This graph tells you the horrific tale of what has just played out in a few months on the global equity markets. It shows you the key stock exchanges of the world economy. And you can see global investors became aware of the threat posed by COVID-19 around mid-March. This is when it started spreading very rapidly throughout Europe, and the first few cases arrived in the United States. And you can see that it's the realization almost dawned on investors simultaneously that this virus isn't going to be like its predecessor, SARS, which remained fairly contained within Asia. This is actually going to spread and affect the world at large. And once this realization dawned on investors, there was blind panic. And what we saw was a massive sell-off in late March from equity markets, the contagion of that spread to virtually every single country and virtually every stock exchange. We saw similar behavior in Africa, and we, of course, saw similar actions on the JSE. So very, very sharp sell-off across the globe in terms of equities. And ironically, since then, we've actually seen equity prices rise all the way back up again. In the United States, they're back to pre-crisis levels on both the Dow Jones and on the S&P 500. On the NASDAQ, has actually been hitting new record highs. Of course, this is a high-tech index, so it lists mainly high-tech companies, and they are assumed to be the key beneficiaries from the COVID-19 effect, and that they are fairly resilient to that. And not only resilient to that, there would probably have been an increase in demand for the likes of your Amazons and your Netflixes and so forth as a result of COVID-19. So the NASDAQ, it looks almost like nothing happened, like nothing hit the world economy. It has now hit record highs again. In Europe, we've seen a similar picture where equity prices have pulled back. And except for, of course, the two ones that are out there, which is the French CAC 40, which is still well below the levels it was pre-crisis. And of course, also the United Kingdom's FTSE 100, still well below the levels where it were pre-crisis. So for the others, in Europe, pretty much very close to being back to pre-crisis levels. So this is very, very confusing, this massive sell-off followed by this very nice and solid rally. Now, what is this based on? Is it based on any kind of fundamentals? Is there anything, any sort of substance behind this rally? Well, the truth of the matter is that it is probably a little bit unrealistic. In the sense that the real effects from COVID-19 will still play out. So what has it been based on? Well, the markets are clearly betting on a kind of V-shaped recession, where you take a hit in the second quarter of the year, and then you come bouncing back in the third and final quarter of the year, and going into 2021, everything is hunky-dory again, and you're growing at a fairly rapid pace. And the markets are certainly betting on that. And so far, if you are, in fact, a bull and you are heavily exposed to the equity market. Economic statistics has largely supported your theory, because if you look at retail sales, industrial sales, industrial production, trade, whether it be on the import or export side, we have seen a big hit occur in April. April appeared to have been the trough. And from May into June, we've actually seen big recoveries come through in all of those economic indicators. The reasons are obvious. What we saw happening from May onwards is that most of your major economies, from China to Europe, and even the United States, although they appear to have certainly underestimated how rapidly COVID can spread, nonetheless, they've all eased lockdown restrictions, and their economic activity is in the process of returning to normal. It is not quite normal yet, but it is in the process of returning to normal. And with that, we have, of course, seen the world economy recover. So that is really what's behind this big bounce we've seen in equity prices across the globe. Another factor that, of course, has been very material is that the moment COVID-19 resulted in very severe lockdown measures and trade and travel restrictions, we have seen an overwhelming and a very positive and very enormous policy response from most of your countries out there. What we've seen from the monetary policy side is that all your major central banks have slashed interest rates either to slightly below zero, in the case of the United States, back to the sorts of levels that prevailed during the global financial crisis, where their base lending rate, the rate at which banks fund their capital, is now essentially very close to zero, 0.25%. And then, of course, they didn't stop there. They also started quantitative easing, which in layman's terms is just simply printing money all over again. And we have seen in all of your major central banks that they've been growing their balance sheets dramatically. In the United States, there's been an explosion in the U.S. Federal Reserve's balance sheets, the assets on their balance sheets, as they have started quantitative easing all over again. And they are, in fact, printing money or buying assets with newly printed money, whether it be government bonds or whether it be corporate bonds, which for the first time ever the U.S. Federal Reserve is doing, or whether they're providing special facilities to households, which, by the way, is also the first time ever the U.S. Federal Reserve has directly aimed support at households. And all of this, of course, the aim is to keep as many businesses as possible open and therefore, in the process, protect as many jobs. So they're flooding the market with liquidity again. And, of course, equity markets like this. Low interest rates, ample liquidity, liquidity looking for a home. Over time, it eventually flows towards your risky assets, and equities would be in that category. So without a doubt, the overwhelming monetary response that we have seen to the COVID-19 crisis has been a big, big factor driving the recovery in equity markets and in asset prices in general. Having said that, though, there is growing concern among many investors about the printing of money. There is a sense that it is putting the global monetary system at risk. At some point, you might have a situation where it actually doesn't lift economic demand. And if that doesn't occur, if demand doesn't recover, you will have a situation of too much money chasing too few goods, which Africa, of course, knows what that feels like. Some African countries, in any case. And Latin America definitely knows what that feels like. And that generally results in inflation. So you're seeing that although investors are returning to the equity market with vigor, some are also hedging their bets. And they are putting their money in something that they consider to be almost a hedge against uncertainty and a hedge against the global monetary system. And that has, of course, been gold. So gold has been incredibly resilient. That is good for East Africa, you know, because you have got substantial gold and diamond producers. Diamonds have not had the same wonderful little bounce that gold has had. But nonetheless, it is a commodity that keeps its value along with gold. So gold is actually viewed as a currency at the moment. It is being treated as a currency as opposed to the dollar. And as a result, we have seen that gold prices have gone up very, very strongly, which is good for many African countries. Oil prices, of course, there are many African countries that are oil exporters. For them, the developments on that front has not been that encouraging. But for East Africa, which predominantly are oil importing countries like South Africa, movement in oil prices are generally supportive. You know, we have seen oil prices implode globally. And since then, of course, after it's hit its lows in early April, a recovery of sorts have started. It seems very steep, but the truth of the matter is oil is still miles away from the levels that prevailed prior to COVID-19 striking the world economy. So oil price is still low. The general consensus among your oil exports is that, experts, is that oil prices will remain fairly low and the recovery will be a slow one. And what that essentially means for all oil importing countries is that, of course, it will help to keep a lid on prices. Now, I know in East Africa, you've had this locust infestation. Crops have been threatened. Food prices are moving higher as a result of that. But if oil also exploded in the process, that would have put even greater pressure on the region. So the fact that oil prices are at least low will take a little bit of the pain off inflation. It will take the edge off it. And, you know, it will just help to contain inflationary pressure and at least not add further to the burden of households during this crisis. So that is where we are as far as the markets is concerned. It's been a seesaw effect. It's literally been the kind of volatility that could leave you punch drunk at the end of the day. But the reality is, for whatever the market movements, they are really all attempts to try and anticipate what is likely to happen in the real economy, what is likely to happen to company earnings, and what is likely to happen to household jobs, because it is really household income, the globe, the world over, that determines the strength of the world economy. You need both of this. You need production and you need consumption. So basically, that is really what the markets are trying to do. But underlying all of this, COVID-19 will hurt the world economy. If you put the numbers together, if you just look at the hit over April and May when the world economy went into lockdown, it is absolutely unprecedented. There's never been an incident in peacetime where you've actually had a world economy willingly switching off its economies. Bottom line is the impact on the world economy is going to be dramatic. COVID-19 and economic lockdown has delivered a shock on the supply side, and it has delivered a shock on the demand side. And at the moment, the IMF has revised their growth numbers down. In fact, it's not growth numbers, but they do now anticipate that the world economy will shrink by 4.9% in 2020. They then expect the world economy to recover. They see advanced countries shrinking by as much as 8% in 2020. And they are less negative about emerging and developing economies, which really is what the African continent largely consists of. They anticipate that they will only contract in 2020 by slightly over 3%. So put it all together, we are looking at deep recession in 2020. In fact, the deepest recession since the Great Depression of the late 1920s and the early 1930s. The rate of decline at this point in the world economy exceeds what occurred during the global financial crisis. So we are in a bit of a tough spot here. What will be the impact on Africa? It will hit Africa from all fronts indirectly. The fact that the world economy is shrinking means there will be less demand for our export products. Our export products predominantly tends to be raw commodities. Therefore, we'll take a hit in terms of volumes and we'll take a hit in terms of prices. It, of course, for especially East Africa, will impact very severely on the global tourism industry, global airline industry, transport, logistical services will be affected by COVID-19 and the lockdown. And in fact, tourism will probably be one of the last industries that will see any kind of lifting of restrictions. Global travel will be hurt dramatically, probably the worst type of decline we have seen in peacetime since the Second World War. So that has very severe implications for East Africa, which is a very attractive tourism spot, and especially for Kenya. So it's going to hit us from that front. And to the extent that that results in hotels and resorts coming under pressure, either folding or retrenching workers or cutting costs in order to stay in business, that of course has a ripple effect into employment, and then it has a ripple effect into income. Now there are less people earning an income, less people with the ability to spend. And it is through these indirect channels that COVID-19 will have a dramatic impact on Africa, on East Africa, and also in the country I live on. In South Africa, in fact, we are anticipated to shrink very badly in South Africa. Now, this is the IMF's latest forecast, where they've even updated the categories for the different regions. And you can see it's a very dismal picture for 2020. At this point, they remain hopeful for 2021. And they really do believe that the world economy will manage to put COVID-19 behind them by the end of this year, and that we can look forward to a recovery of this very low base, of this very deep recession in 2021. They're actually quite upbeat about the prospects for sub-Saharan Africa relative to the rest of the world. That's the way you should look at it. They do think sub-Saharan Africa will in fact contract this year by 3.2%. This is now the region's, the whole of sub-Saharan Africa's GDP. It will contract this year, but it will grow by about 3.4% next year, which means it's going to gain about 0.2% by the end of next year. So they believe that Africa will be able to recover from the hit of COVID-19, from the hit of economic lockdown, from the hit of global recession within a year. You can see they don't have quite the same picture for advanced countries. They expect them to contract by 8% this year, then only grow by 4% next year, which means they're anticipating that it will take 2 years to 3 years before your advanced countries will be back to the sort of levels where they were prior to economic lockdown and prior to COVID-19. They're not upbeat on South Africa. You can see that picture there, but I think virtually everybody would agree with them. South Africa has its own problems that is very different from that of your major economies in East Africa. But for sub-Saharan Africa as a whole, it emerges from this picture, not avoiding the pain, not avoiding the impact of COVID-19, not avoiding recession, but at least not being hit as hard as the rest of the world. As for East Africa, it's been an area of growth. It's been an area of relative outperformance in Africa. We have seen that most of the major economies in East Africa has done really well compared to the rest of Africa over the last couple of years, some of them posting incredibly impressive growth rates, Kenya, Tanzania, Ethiopia, very strong growth rates, where the worst of the bunch is in fact still at around 4 to 5% growth. And you know, South Africa would dream of having that sort of growth rate. So they have really been outperforming for an extended period of time, growing very strongly. And the big reason for that, of course, is that we've seen increasingly capital moving towards East Africa, and we have seen a lot of fixed investment activity, especially occurring in Ethiopia and in Tanzania. A lot of that, as in the case of Tanzania, has been related to mining investments in diamond and gold. So we have seen that come through as a result of that. So that's been a big contributor to that, you know, really rapid acceleration in GDP growth in Tanzania. And Ethiopia, it's been more around really making very positive strides in terms of creating an investment environment that is extremely positive for businesses and favorable. And they have reaped the benefit from that. And then, of course, in Rwanda, we've seen similar developments where the regulatory environment has been reformed, red tape has been reduced, transparency has been improved, and we have seen an environment being created in where you can quickly, you know, start a business, and just generally the investment environment is very favorable for businesses. And so as a result, the region has benefited from that. So fixed investment really driving this surge in fixed investment, especially in Tanzania and Ethiopia, behind the region's very strong growth. Having said that, though, it's not been all good news for East Africa. There are some old enemies that are returning. Most East African countries, along with South Africa, much of sub-Saharan Africa, has actually been running very big and large budget deficits. So fiscal finances have not been managed well. And we have a situation where expenditure just persistently exceeds revenue. And as a result, you've been running these big budget deficits in Ethiopia and Kenya and Tanzania. And South Africa has been even worse. But really, at an unsustainable level, no country can consistently year after year run a budget deficit of over 3% of GDP without at some point or the other running into debt problems and ultimately running into external funding problems and ultimately running into really an outright sovereign debt crisis. So for many African countries, COVID-19 has already made that a reality. Many African countries have had to turn to the IMF for bridging finance, for support over this period where they simply do not have the funds to cope with the current situation. But the fact that we, during the good times, run budget deficits is something that should concern us as Africans. This is when we should be saving so that we have ammunition and we have fiscal space to support our economy during the bad times. Now, that's what's happened. COVID-19 has come to an Africa that is generally in a far worse fiscal position than they were just after the IMF's 1990 program and in most of the 2000s, where, you know, deficits were slashed and debt levels came down. Africa has built up that debt again by running consistent fiscal deficits. And as a result, of course, we have seen that debt levels have been climbing. Having said that, though, it is still well below what it was in the 1990s, but it is climbing. And that is the problem. We have very little fiscal space to support our economy as we now hit this trouble spot. So on the monetary policy side, it's been a very mixed picture. Some countries have handled, has established, you know, monetary policy discipline, fairly transparent processes. They've brought inflation under control. In other countries, you still see that inflation is rising very rapidly, like, for example, in Ethiopia. A lot of that, of course, is a function of very rapid growth over the last couple of years. But if you're talking about inflation of over 10%, it is starting to become destructive. So on the inflation front and from the monetary policy front, the story is a mixed one. With some countries showing clear success and others having, you know, really increasingly got an issue with high levels of inflation. So if we put this all together, East Africa has been doing really well. It has outperformed the rest of sub-Saharan Africa. It has some of the same problems that many other sub-Saharan African countries do, mainly that it's running very high budget deficits, and that in a few countries in East Africa, you've got inflation that is raging out of control. But in East Africa in general, debt is much lower than it was during the 90s and the 2000s. So even though it's climbing, it's not reached that point where it's critical yet. So what do we think will be the impact? Well, the experts out there actually believe that East Africa will be one of the few regions in the world that will still hold on to growth in 2020. So this is the good news for East Africa. They anticipate that Kenya's growth will slow dramatically from 5.6% in 2009 to 1% this year, but they don't anticipate it to shrink. They expect that Tanzania's growth will slow from over 6% to 2%, and that Ethiopia's growth will continue at more or less 7% going forward. So this is a region in Africa that is going to be fairly resilient and that is going to continue to grow. COVID-19 will hurt you. It will have an impact on your region and it will have an impact on investment activity, but it's not going to topple you into outright recession. And I think that is good news. And as a result, fixed investment activity in Africa will probably come under a bit of pressure going forward. But to be honest with you, it's still going to hold up. And if we look forward to what has been said and what we hear from investors out there, there's still genuine interest in East Africa, and especially in the construction industry, and especially, therefore, in the property industry. and property at large, whether it be residential or whether it be commercial. One of the key problems that you'll have to deal with is for the whole of Africa, really, we will see those large budget deficits become even larger. But generally speaking, what I've heard from many investors is that they believe the fact that you will probably see in Kenya a bigger and larger budget deficit will focus the minds of politicians and will probably have a positive outcome in that they will support only those projects that truly make economic sense. So it's not necessarily going to be as bad for Africa and for East Africa as it will be for the rest of Africa. We have picked up quite a lot of interest from investors in East Africa, especially in the property space. And as I said before, in the construction space, in general, there is support for continued investment in East Africa. The general sort of sentiment we're getting out there is once this COVID-19 thing dies off, we are still interested in projects in East Africa. And essentially, I don't think that East Africa will struggle to fund investment projects, whether it be a large economic infrastructure or whether it be residential or commercial property. These are just some of the projects that have been mentioned along the way by investors from different countries that we've been in contact with, that there is some enthusiasm about. I'm not going to go through everything on the list, but I think it proves that there's a strong investment case to be made for East Africa, regardless of COVID-19, regardless of some of the challenges you may face going forward. To end up and to wrap up this presentation, I really just want to make a couple of points about Africa in general. And this applies to East Africa, to Kenya, to Ethiopia. And certainly, we need to look at this crisis as an opportunity. And the opportunity should not be for government to spend more. The opportunity should really be for government to focus on doing things better, eliminating waste, eliminating corruption. It is really tragic that in Africa, according to Amnesty International, we are still one of the most corrupt continents in the world. This is what we should use this crisis for, to build the evidence, prosecute those guilty of corruption, and to put in place systems and structures that ensure that we detect corruption quickly and that we effectively address it and we hold people accountable, whether it be through fines, or whether it be through simple old jail time. So this is one area where Africa absolutely has to improve if it wants to attract the kind of funding it needs to grow investment at a consistent rate in the years to come, to deal with poverty on the continent and to create a better future for our people. So that is one issue that I would definitely stress. The other thing where Africa, it's gotten a lot better, but Africa is again emerging on the radars of the various security agencies across the globe in terms of geopolitical conflict, in terms of regional conflict, and of course, in terms of terrorism. There are still too many reds on this map of Africa as far as armed conflict is concerned, and just in terms of violent protest, violent disruption. This is what it measures. And unfortunately, this is something we will have to deal with in the years ahead. Again, we should use this crisis to strengthen our systems in terms of dealing with terrorism, in terms of resolving regional conflicts. And then lastly, many African countries have made enormous strides in promoting and changing legislation and regulation to bring about greater economic freedom. But we have a long road to go to the point where we are truly free in an economic sense. Now, there is a very strong correlation between economic freedom, rapid economic growth, and much higher living standards and levels of income and wealth in a nation. Freer countries generally grow faster, and as a result, their citizens become wealthier and their income becomes more secure. And this is towards the direction towards Africa to which Africa has to move. Now, as I said, we've made enormous progress over the past decade in that regard, and East Africa in particular. In many ways, you have been the leading jurisdiction as far as that's concerned. But I think that we must keep it up. We must not regress. And there are signs in Tanzania, there are signs in Ethiopia that we might be regressing. And I think it is very important that we continue to reform, we continue to eliminate often, you know, extremely high compliance costs, confusing regulation and legislation, inconsistent interference by the state, and we move towards creating a truly transparent, truly fair, and truly clear investment framework. Then I really do think, especially East Africa, has huge potential to do even better than they've already done during the past decade. Thank you. That's all for me.